J-Baba.
J-Baba.
Happy happiness, but we're celebrating the anniversary of Mara's 11th year of going to the Lobo Baba. Yeah, which yesterday. And I thought, in lieu of what Mitch said, I thought I'd read something that I wrote this last year. It's very short, but I was trying, you know, people say, why don't you write about your life in India? And I haven't really written much but this one little paragraph, but I'll start with that. Jay Bob. I know that it was my great, grand, good fortune to spend my 30s with Mara, God's beloved. In Mara's presence, I felt more alive, more capable, more loving, more loved, more alert, and yet content than anywhere else on the earth. Not to mention those moments of real stupidity and foolishness, which were all too much a part of this most extraordinary relationship. How dearest Mara put up with the likes of me, trained me, guided me, and shared her love for beloved Baba all those years is proof indeed of her most amazing love. I was in need, to be sure, of learning to live a life that Baba would be happy with. He carried me to the source of that which pleased him most, his Mara. Having once met her, there was nowhere else for me to go, for I was keenly aware of my great, grand, good fortune and was not going to let this one get away. I thought I'd start actually thinking about Baba's room in Mara's Hut. Because there's some little things that Mara would tell us about the room that she specifically wanted others to know, and little tidbits that she would, you know, when we would give a tour or something, she would want us to share some of these, I can't do all of it, but some of the cute little things about Baba's room. So we'll walk into the room, and I don't know if any of you know that the cushion where you take darshan on the ground, Baba's foot cushion, was made for Baba by Mara and the women. The doctor had said that he had to have his feet raised up to ease the pain in his hip. But they made the cushion, but inside the cushion is some cotton that was actually growing in Mara's eye. And there's a cushion on the bed itself behind the photograph. And that was because when he laid, because of the intense pain in his neck from all the bowing that he would do and just general, all of the work that he would do, when he would lie on one side, he'd have to raise up this hand to relieve the strain on his neck. And then when he'd turn over, they would turn the pillow. And he'd raise up his hand on the other side. So you see that square pillow there. And so you just realize that they would shift it back and forth when he would turn over. He would shift it. His other main, the pillow for his head, was they would always have spare pillows in the room in the night over on the side. That side where Baba's hair is now, that flap of Baba's hair. And they would put pillows there. And spare ones, because he would perspire a lot in the nighttime, especially up in his neck and things like that. So they would have spare pillows for him, and they would have fresh leather change and things like that in the night. And on the little table where Baba's hand, the cast of Baba's hand is, in the night he used to like snacks, salty things or something like that. So they would keep little munchies over there for him in the nighttime. That's what was over there. And on the table beside the bed was just a glass of water, mostly. And of course, there was a mosquito curtain that came down. But they didn't like, there was no electricity, and he didn't, in order to see him in the night when he was gesturing, they had to have a lantern of some sort, but he didn't like the smell of kerosene. He was very, very sensitive to smells and things like that. So they had to have a kerosene lantern for him, but they had to be placed outside. So you see that lantern stand outside Baba's room? He would put the lantern in there, and the light, enough light would shine in, and they could see the gesturing that he was doing inside the mosquito curtain. So, and of course he had to have a man sitting there within the nighttime on guard, whatever Baba needed. Also, it helped keep away the disembodied spirits that we know, that people that wanted to contact people, and having a man sitting there would help keep these disembodied spirits from bothering Baba, which was important in the nighttime. He never slept. Gohar said he never slept. She slept outside the room, and she said basically all night long something would be going on. He'd be conversing with the Mandali members, something like that. She said she never slept. She was aware of what was going on with Baba all night long, and that she'd have to be up for him all day long too. Now, little things. Mara would also be very particular about near the head of Baba's bed, there's a little alcove, and there are three little pictures up in there. And there's a picture of Jesus with Mary Magdalene. It's like Mary Magdalene. And it's not, it actually looks like it's in New Hampshire, so it's a little bit of artistic license, something. You know, it's just in the trees and things, but she's asking for forgiveness. And that was sent to Bob Dumera by Ruth Rosen. And I hope you don't all know all of these stories. And so there's this, so Ruth Rosen sent this postcard of Jesus and Mary, or a representation of Jesus and Mary, to Mara, and Baba was present. And Mara loved, she loved the feeling of forgiveness in Jesus' form, and how he was supporting and caring for her. She was being so, she was asking for such forgiveness. And she loved the drape of his sadra and all things like that. So she brought it in and she showed it to Baba. Isn't this a beautiful picture? Baba was resting. And Mara said that Baba took the postcard and held it, and he kissed the picture of Jesus, and then he said, "I was Jesus." So she framed it. She kept it. She thought that was most worth saving. So she kept it up. She kept it in Baba's room. All the things in there, she kept, because somehow or another she'd been deeply touched by them, by the picture, by the story, something that meant. So what you see in Baba's room is obvious, according to Mara, what she wanted, her taste. And for example, she would, what shall I say? She would at any moment go into that room. In any moment. She would come, certainly when she would come back from her vacation, she'd get out of the car straight into Baba's room. At, you know, any time she could show us anything in the room, Baba's feet, for example, was very touching. She would come to the cast of Baba's feet and she would say, she would bow to Baba's feet and then she would say, "Now," as if to say he's everywhere, she would say, "Now, if you ever want to bow to Baba's feet, just bring them to you. Just bring his feet to you and bow down, wherever you are. It's not just here." She was, these items represented Baba to her, to be taken everywhere to be. But, okay. Mara, the one thing that she said to me once that I love to share, Sam heard it yesterday, Karina's heard it, but this is a little thing that she once said. She was, it was summertime, hot. She was heading to Pune in about a month. And I had just come from Pune to Ahmednagar on the road. It was a very bumpy road. And I'm thinking, oh gosh, next year, next month, Mara's going to be driving to Pune and the road is very bumpy and it's going to be an uncomfortable ride for her. This is Baba's beloved. How can he take her to Pune over such a bumpy road? Maybe something will happen. Somebody will come and fix the road. It hurts my heart to think of her going to Pune on her vacation on this terrible road. So I walked up to her very naively and I said, "Mara," I said, "you know, the road to Pune is very bumpy right now." I said, "You're going to be traveling on it next month." I said, maybe the road crews will come out and fix the road for you so you'll have a smoother ride to Pune next month. "They'll never do that," she says. "And anyhow, whatever money that they get, they'll take it, they'll pocket 3/4 of it, and they'll make a very thin road, and it'll break up within a couple of weeks." She always said that. But then I said, "Well, then maybe Baba, you know, maybe Baba will do something. Maybe he'll encourage them to do a better job. Maybe Baba will do something for you so that your road to Pune next month is a smoother road." "No, no." She said, "No, no. He's not like that. Baba's not like that." "He's not like that. He's just up there with a pencil and paper writing down the things that we do for him." And that struck me. I said, "Now that's there." Her offering, her whole life is an offering to Baba. Her whole life. Everything she does. And she's not looking for him to. The energy around her, the focus around her, what she was interested in, what she brought out of us, it was just, you know, it was our love for Baba, our effort. She would always say, "He's loved us now. It's our time to love him. It's our turn to love him. What is the offering? You know, what can we give?" And I was ready. At that point, I was ready to just try and find all parts of my being and give those to Baba. Of course, that's a long, long time. But it made me think of another story that Mani would tell, how he helped them learn to forget themselves to such a degree that they allowed his work to flow. They were so available for Baba's work, and they didn't get in the way of what he wanted to do, regardless of what they thought of it, regardless of how it looked, regardless of the person, they were so in touch with what wanted to happen for Baba's sake, what any of us wanted to do. And there was a story that at Amartiti time, Mara and Mani, they'd all gone to Mirabad, and they packed their suitcases, and they, you know, they go for, in those days they were going for 3 days, so they would pack very carefully, you know, I only need this one sari, I need this one blouse, this one petticoat, this one skirt and blouse, this one pair of shoes, you know, very carefully they would pack. So they were at Amartiti, and in the middle of, before the 31st, this was on the 30th, means that the next day they were going to put their saris on, observe silence and all that at 12 o'clock. So on the 30th, somebody comes up to Mani, a woman comes up to Mani with two saris. And she says, please, Mani, please, please, tomorrow is my son's first birthday. Please, please, will you and Mara wear these tomorrow for Amartiti? Please, please, it's my son's first birthday. And she was with this so much love. And it meant so much to her. And they'd gotten all the way up there. And, you know, by that time, Mani, they're in Mani's lap. And she's in, and so Mani looks and she goes, thank you, yes, smile. Well, they get back into their room and they look at these saris and they're so garish. And they look at them and they think, there's no way we can wear these. On the other hand, that woman really wants us to wear them like that. So Mara and Mani, they can hardly look at them. You know, Mani says, but the amazing thing was, we opened up our suitcases, and we looked at the glasses that we had brought to go with the other saris, she said, and they went.
You see.
And she said, we wore them the next day, and they looked wonderful. They just looked wonderful. And it just makes me think how, you know, we never know what a person's offering it. We never know, you know, people, God only knows what's really behind these things. And if you let them happen the way they did, if you let that happen, it's going to have a beautiful effect. And way beyond anything you would imagine. And probably turn your mind around a little bit too in the same time. A lovely thing that Mani once did on Mara's behalf, on Baba's behalf, which stunned me, really stunned me, which has to do with what we can do for him, how we can live our lives for him, how we can keep him nearby, how we can serve him. Mara and Mani and Gohari and Mary used to go to Pune for vacation, and after Baba dropped his body. And first, for a while, they go to Mahabaleshwar, but their driver started to get bad blood pressure. He couldn't drive them up to Mahabaleshwar anymore, so they had to stay on the flat. So they ended up going to the Pune Club in Pune, and it was this wonderful, lot of little bongos. All year long, other people used it, but about 3 or 4 days before they were going to go for their summer vacation, Palu would go and he would clean it all up. And it was two rooms, one room for Meru and Gohar with a bathing room and a bath and a changing room here, and then a room for Mani and Mara when Mara was there. They would stay in that room. Now, I never saw it. I never saw it when Mara was staying there. But I would hear that they would go and they would talk about the bungalow and they would talk about how much they liked it. There was a ram who thought he was a dog, and he used to follow the dogs around in the front. I mean, there's all, and they used to talk about it. They could sit there and they could watch the little people go play tennis. And they were just far away, enough away in the trees where they could watch some people going to the club shop at the Pune Club and have a little activity. Once in a while, a party would be going over there. So they loved the spot and they loved the bungalow and they loved everything about it, and they especially liked the setup. And what was going to happen was the club had decided to redo these rooms. So Mani had said to me, after I was going to Mahabaleshwar myself for a break, and she said, after you go to Mahabaleshwar, will you stop by the Pune Club with your camera? I'd like you to photograph the place because they're going to change it. And we want to see it the way it was when we used to go there. So I said, great, this is wonderful for me. I'd never seen where they spent their summers in Pune, so I was really looking forward to this. And go here and there with Mani. So what happened was I came down from Mahabaleshwar, and I got off the bus or whatever, and I got there. And as the bungalow was long, and Meru and Gohar were here, and Mani's room was over on this side, and Meru and Gohar were encouraging me to come in and saying hello, J. Baba, and greeting me and all that. So I came in that door, and it was nice, wonderful to see them. And then they said, now Mani's in the next room. So I went back to where the door was, and I walked in the door expecting to greet Mani. And I suddenly, my whole being rushed over to this other bed, this empty bed. And I went over, and my knees were on the ground before I knew it, and I had my head on the bed, and it was Mara, and Mara was there, and I was taking Mara's darshan, and I was like, she's right here. And I looked, and then there was Baba's picture and some flowers, and it's I sort of look around to Mike, and I'm like, she's here. How have you done this? You've kept her here with you on your vacation. She's here with you during this period of time. This was the bed, then they would go over, this is where they would say their prayers. But Mara was with them. And I thought, my God, what a capacity a heart has. I mean, if you're really, really longing for Baba, longing for Mara, be with you, whatever, it's no joke, you can keep them right there. You keep them right there. I was blown away by that when I saw it. And I said to myself, you got a job ahead of yourself, Casey. I mean, if a person can do this, this is the life's work. This is the work of many lifetimes to learn to keep Baba close by, and it's possible. By that experience, I knew it was absolutely possible. And how do we do that? We start slowly, little areas in your life and things like that. But a big part of it, I think, has to do with recognizing in others what they're also trying to do with Baba, allowing that to happen. And realizing that he's behind all of this. It's his effort, it's his love, it's their love, but it's the expression of love, and let it happen. Even if something happens that you say, I really don't like the way this looks, or something, it will pan out. If it's an expression of Baba's love, it'll go just where it belongs, it'll pan out. Now, I was thinking a little bit of talking about my dancing that I did in India today when Rafael played that piano piece, because I had a wonderful thing happen. First of all, I was a modern dancer when I danced. This does have to do with Mara, eventually, I promise you, we'll get back to Mara. I was a modern dancer, and I studied ballet at the end of my career in New York, even with Margaret Krask, and I used to practice with those pointe shoes to strengthen my feet, simply to strengthen my feet. I had never taken a step across the floor with pointe shoes on. I could do a couple little steps like this, but mostly it was to strengthen my feet at the bar and to learn about that experience of being way up there on those toe shoes. But I was not a toe dancer. In fact, modern dancer. And Mara, when I got to India, she knew I was a dancer. She would ask me to dance in the garden. She would ask me to do little things, and I loved it. And I was, now in retrospect, there was one costume I was wearing. It was so sort of scanty. And I thought, gee, I would never do that now. But they didn't care. It's another thing. It was my offering. They didn't care. The only thing that happened, at a certain point, I'd stop. And some perspiration was pouring. It was not pouring down my face. I was right in front of Mary Money. I was so embarrassed. And at the end, Money comes up and she goes, oh, that golden drop of perspiration that went down your chin. Anyhow, but what happened was then dance, I got so wrapped up in serving Mara and helping her in whatever job she gave me, and I really let go of dance for quite some time. And I said to myself, no, I've got to branch out. I want my life to be more than just dancing, and I need to find other areas to work on, and whatever, as a person, not just a dancer. So I was very happy in that life with her. Somewhere in the back, I think of dancing on occasion, gained some weight, didn't feel like a dancer, felt like more like an elderly woman, way elderly, slowed down, but it didn't matter. Because I said to myself, this period of time, this is for my soul. This is way beyond this is definitely good for me. And I was so happy even just to hear words spoken there. You're so used to being in the West and hearing a word spoken with all kinds of innuendos, just laced with some sort of strange experience or something. In India, when I was first there, I kept going, oh, just let me hear these words spoken so purely. Just the experience there was just, it was so pure. It really was. It was life lived for Baba, and everything had to do with him, and nobody was downing anything. Everybody was upping everything. Everybody was, it was just the way it was, and words were light, and they had a beautiful meaning, and I was enthralled by all of that, and all of them. Anyhow, so on a rare occasion, Steve Klein would make a funny little play in Langley Hall, and he would ask me to come on as a Chinese duck wearing a funny hat, on my pointe shoes. Just come in and do a funny thing and go out. So I would do funny little things like that, and I would just, so Mara saw that I could actually walk in those shoes, those toe shoes. Mind you, that's all I could do. But she would see that. But she got this idea somehow that I could do more in those shoes. Typical. Mara would get you to do things you I mean, you really realize her understanding of Baba and how what you gave 150% every minute of your day, and she would get to do stuff that you just knew you couldn't do, and she would get you to do it because that's what wanted to happen for Baba right now. So she knew I was an issue. So after about 4 years, now I would gain some weight, and I was, you know, not thinking of dancing, and it was February. Mind you, her birthday's in December. It was February, and she was napping. She was, and I would help her nap. I would help her get the covers on. Yvonne and I would alternate this, but this was my week. And so Mara was lying down, and I was helping lift the covers when she was lying down. And just as she had her head on the pillow, Money walks in with a boombox. And she puts the boombox on her bed, and she goes, Mara, look, Peter Booth has just brought us this boombox. And Uta has just sent us this music. And she presses down the button, and out comes the Blue Danube. And Mara had danced with Baba, the Blue Danube, in the house briefly. So Mani was reminding her of all of that. And so Mara, she's lying down on her other side, but she's lying down. And Mani started to play the music, and she did that wake up that every actress longs to do. It's like she woke up. She just woke up. She sat up, and she rose up, and she was just enthralled with this music. Then she and must have been remembering dancing with Baba in the house there. Then she looks over at me and she goes, you could dance to this music on my birthday for me. She goes, on those shoes. I'm sure I will. Okay, then here comes the job of taking the body out of mothballs. I was so tired, so body wouldn't move and things like this. Well, from February till December, I trained, I have to say. And I cried every day. I lie down, I try and stretch. It'll be better tomorrow. It'll be better. It will be better tomorrow. But managed to get to a pretty good place where I ended up doing an 8-minute ballet on those shoes, full out. And she, you know, it was one of those things I would never have. I had a tape of Margaret Crass teaching a class, a ballet class. And I played that every day. That's what I would give myself, that class every day. And got back into shape, God knows how. And then that started a series of more, a little more dancing then. And of course, that was at the amphitheater. We were performing on the amphitheater. In those days, the amphitheater, the floor of the amphitheater could not have been rougher. Hills and valleys, hills and valleys, hills and valleys. It hadn't been polished. The roughest Farsi stone you could ever imagine like that. So you do a full run through in your shoes. It cost $35 a pair of shoes, which I had to beg from somebody in the state. Do a full run through and the shoes are gone. You know, I had 5 pairs of shoes and I had to space it out how much I could practice and where am I going to step because there's a valley there, there's a volcano there, you know. And the great thing, and she gave, Mara gave me a scarf, a beautiful turquoise blue scarf with shiny things in it, so I made a costume, and I made that the sleeves of the costume, that was nice. But a funny thing happened, because Alan came in for about 2 minutes and helped me with the dance, just as a gesture, he was sort of a gesture. Well, Alan and I had managed to, we choreographed this whole piece at the back of the stage, and as I come out, I'll say, as I come out on the stage, I'm coming out on the stage, I realized, they've put huge speakers at the back of the stage exactly where Alan and I were going to be doing all our dancing. So I'm coming out, Mara's there, and she's in the front. I'm going, I got to get a message to Alan. I got to get a message to Alan. There's no space for us to work out. It turned out to be really good. I was really happy. Erich was happy with it. Mara was very happy. She said, I think it was good. She said, everybody liked it. That means it was good. She said, I think it was good. She would always, in the house, she would always do things like remind you where Baba was, you know, remind you that your focus was in the right place. For example, where Baba's tree is, there's that wonderful little window seat by Baba's tree, and she would give me work to do that needed a lot of sunlight, so seam ripping or something like that. So she'd have me, she'd say, now sit over there and do this work or something. But when you would sit in such a way that your back wasn't to the tree because you knew she wouldn't want your back to the tree. She wanted you to have the light to be doing the work, you know. So I remember kind of sitting once like this, fudging and trying to, I was doing the work and she walked and she said, that's right. She would know that. I was sitting on the bed, on Gohir's bed once, and there was a picture of Baba on Gohir's pillow. And I was talking to Mara and she looked at me and she said, never put your back to Baba, immediately. So she started to give you that sense, you know, just kind of little things that helped remind you all the time where he was or where, not where he was, but where your thoughts were in relationship to him. She bumped into a little table one time, and unfortunately Baba's picture was on that and fell over in the classroom. And I thought, I wasn't there when it happened. I heard it happen, and all of a sudden I heard Miru call out, "Casey!" like that. And I came running over, and Mira was so distraught that she had done this to Baba's picture. She couldn't handle it. She'd gone. She'd left the scene. Miru wouldn't even let her see it, that the glass had broken or anything. Miru says, "Go fix this as fast as you can. And don't let her, you know, just don't even talk to her about it, just go fix it." So I got on my scooter, I went to town, I got the glass, I came back. You've never seen joy on a person's face when I said, "Mira, here's the picture back," you know. It's like, yes, you've pleased her. There's nothing like pleasing her. She was so happy it was all back in place and fine and things like that. But the notion of pleasing her, I mean, I said to my, when that happened, I said, if pleasing Mira is this wonderful, what is it to please Baba? So wonderful. And that was really, you know, that you're, I mean, that obviously around her, that was the thing you were trying to do. That was, it wasn't, she wasn't a master, she wasn't teaching, she was just in part, she was just, because she knew what it was to please him. She knew what it was to stay with him all the time. She knew the beauty of it. She knew, and she also knew what he'd given her. Because once I was coming up to the porch, she was sitting on the porch, telling stories. She was very involved in the story she was telling. I'd been there now some years, and she was used to my being there and stuff like that. But she was involved talking to other people, and I'd come from the clinic. And Gohar was sitting up on the platform up there. So I came walking up, and I saw Mira was busy, so I didn't even greet her or anything like that. And I went and sat next to Gohar, and I had to ask Gohar a question. So I'm sitting there, I kind of lean over and start to ask Gohar the question. Suddenly there's silence. And I know there's something up, and I look over. And that's Mira, and she looks in front of everybody. She says, "Always greet me first." And you know, it was like, it wasn't an ego thing with her. It was like what Baba gave to her, that was what we were there for. You know, at that point, she was the closest thing to him at that time. She knew it was the best thing for us, and she also knew that focusing on her was a way of training one's mind to stay focused on Baba. You know, you train, because it wasn't easy all the time. And there are lots of other things you'd like to be doing. Once I used to go to Maribor to play volleyball on my off days, and I used to love, I mean, I'm a jock. Remember, I was a jock when I was little. And I loved volleyball. And I would go for maybe a year or a year and a half, I would go and I would play. And it upset me, because I used to go there and not go up the hill. I would go there and I would play volleyball. And I just liked it so much. And that I felt was wrong. So I changed that. I changed that habit. I would go up and up. But then at a certain point, I also felt that I was mixing it up too much with the guys. I liked it. And I was enjoying it. And I, very honestly, I said to myself, this doesn't really stack up with my life here. And I also wanted to wear bangles. And you can't wear bangles and play volleyball. It's really, or you wear big ones. You want to wear small bangles. They stay on your arm longer. They don't break. They're big. You hit them. Right, you know, so the smaller the bangle, the longer it stays on your hand. And if you have small bangles on your hand, you don't take them off once you put them on. I had this problem. Volleyball or bangles? So I said to myself, you know, I'm going to let go of the volleyball. I like it. I think I like it too much. For Baba's sake, I'm going to let go of the volleyball. I'm going to wear the bangles. I'm just going to do it. Nobody's going to know. I'm just going to do it. Stop playing volleyball. Next week, Mara comes up to me with a little bangle in her hand. She says, "Do you think you could find some of these matching bangles for me in the bazaar?" And that started years of bangle shopping for Mara. And I thought, you know, I did the right thing. I did that for Baba. I did the right thing. And look at the effect that it's having. And that was incredible. And that, you know, just deepened that relationship with her. To talk to her about the bangles, what color and what size. Tried them on and all this kind of thing. It was incredible. I said, that was one smart thing you did. You see, that was one smart thing. She kept you occupied. She kept you occupied thinking, what can I do for her? What more can I do for her? What can I do for her? What can I do for her? I'd stay up. I would do a lot of her studying, a lot of her sewing. And I would come, I would take it home with me when I couldn't finish in Arizona, and I still had my ballet bar in the kitchen. It was very comfortable to sit with my feet up on my bar because I could relax my back. And I would sew like till 11 o'clock or 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. in the night, because I was by myself and I was living by myself. And it would be getting a little hard in the eyes and things like that, but eyes are still good in those days. But I would do it, and one time I brought something home that I had done for her, and I looked at it and I said, this isn't quite perfect. I will feel a little bad if I hand her this, because it's not quite perfect. She'll never know. But in my heart of hearts, I'll know I haven't done my best job. So I undid all the sewing that I had done. I undid it. Did it all up again. I was up till 11:30, 12 o'clock. Got it all done just right. I was happy with it. Brought it to Marisol, and when I gave it to her, she looked, she said, you must have been up quite late working on this. Yeah. And that's all, you know. But it's like, she picked up, that was the beautiful thing about me. She picked up on what you were doing, Ramal, on that going outside of yourself, going beyond yourself. And, you know, I mean, Baba, I'm sure, did that all the time. Anything you did that was beyond yourself for him, he must have really appreciated that. He must have really loved that. This is sort of a funny story. When I lived in the compound, in the trust office, there was one telephone, that 3666 number that everybody in the universe, all Bible lovers know that's a trust number, which means if you want to call the trust, that's the number you call. Now, I was raised in a doctor's family, so we were really careful about the telephone, not spending too much time on the telephone. And it used to drive me crazy. One unnamed person living in the compound used to talk on their phone, personal calls, local, Ahmed Nagar personal calls, 45 minutes, and I'm going, there might be four people trying to call the trust office for God knows what reasons right now from halfway around the world, and this person is talking to Maribor. And that's driving me crazy. Get your own phone, I used to say to myself. Really mad inside, and probably from my upbringing from the whole phone thing. So this person was on the phone. I was on duty watching the compound. This person was on the phone. And I just walked over after a while. I'd been on the phone for 45 minutes. And I looked and I said, you spent too much time on the phone. While they were talking, I just said, you spent too much time on the trust phone. So I said that. I said it like that. Like that, I said it. So I go to my room a little shaken that I've actually said that, but I felt maybe I should say it. Well, there probably was another way to say it, but I said it that way. So I'm in my room, and suddenly the door, there's a knock at my door, and this person and another person were outside my door, raging at me. How dare I say that? How dare I say that? You know, you have no right to say that. And all the compound servants were watching. They couldn't believe this person just raging at me. And they're all watching because they're my friends too. And they can't believe these two people are just like pounding on me. I said, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. You know, but they were still really mad. So I closed the door. I'm sitting in my room. I can't believe I have to do this, but I have to walk over there and apologize to this people. And I'm sitting by Baba's picture, and I go, I know you want me to do that. Give me a couple of minutes. I can't do it right now. But within 15 minutes, I will stand up, and I will go over there and apologize. And I'm sitting up. I know you want me to do that. I get that, you know. And I was shaking, because I said, I can't go to sleep without solving this, because it was really big thing. I walked over, apologized. It was easy. And that person said, you know, if you had just said it a little more sweetly, I would have listened to you. And it was unbelievable. That person and I, all these people, we're all really actually very good friends right now. You know? Because that really helped me. That really helped me. I mean, I thought, I'm going to do the great thing of going to apologize. I thought that. But what I got in return instead was a very strong message, you know, from Baba. It's like, you've done this, but I'm way ahead of you. Say it. But just say it more sweetly if you have to, you know? And it was really, and I told Erich, actually I told him that experience. I thought he'd be proud of me. And he was. He said, no. He said, you did the right thing. Because it was really hard to do. He really was. I was stuck in that chair for a good 15 minutes, and I said, no, gotta do it. But those are the kinds of, you know, being there, that those kinds of things, there's so much love. You know, you can count on it everywhere, all the time. You can count on it in that atmosphere. You can do these things, and it's just, you know, you have it here too. Now, what else do I want? Oh, this is cute. All of us. All of us story. It's a merit and all of us story. Mara had this thing of not liking to touch envelopes that had come through the mail. She had the order from Bob not to touch them in and all, but she was also very, very clean. And she would look at an envelope and think, spirit's been and who's touched it and probably fallen on the ground. And so when she would ever have to pick up an envelope that had been through the postal system, you'd see her carrying it like this. She wouldn't have to carry it, but she would carry it just like that. She would have other people open the mail. If a big package, heaven forbid, a big package comes, it's all been beat up in the mail, somebody else is going to open that for her. But we loved it. I'll give it a touch. So, but she would carry, if you saw her carrying an envelope like this, you knew she had to, for some reason, she had to remember something about it. Anyhow, so I see her one day in my house walking around carrying a photograph like this. And I can't tell what the photograph is, and I say to myself, that's odd. She's carrying a photograph like that. It's not come through the mail. I wonder, you know, is she squeamish about it? She's not embracing the picture. What is it? Why is she carrying it like this? So I walked up, and she shows me the photograph, and it's a photograph of Oliver. And Oliver is sitting on a sofa. He's in the West, obviously. He's got the full suit, the thing, the hat, and all extra clothes and stuff, and his arms are out like this on the sofa. And a young Baba girl is under either arm. And I'm saying to myself, gee, I wonder what she thinks of Oliver. You know, he's doing this. Maybe that's why she's carrying it like that. I don't know. She looks up and she says, see how he's keeping them warm to Baba. Got it all wrong, Casey. Got it all wrong. She can see so far. She can see through that. She can see what he's doing. And I, you know, eat humble pie, stuff like that happens, and you go, man, they nurture. They all they want is Baba. All they want is for his love to thrive, and they nurture that so well. They just bring that right out. And another story right in my mind, it just flew away just like that. Let's see. Well, let's have a question if there's a, yeah.
I want to know your story, how you come to Baba.
How many of you have already heard this story?
I never heard
that. Okay. Requires a little drink of water. Okay. I was a lucky little girl. I had a wonderful family, wonderful childhood, mom and dad. Picture was perfect. Dad was a doctor. Mom was a mother. She took care of us, four kids. Very, very happy childhood. Not a lot of money around, but very content in our hearts. So I just assumed I would live a life like that. You know, I was very worldly in that regard. I had one period of time when I was 12 when I loved to go to church and I loved to hear about God in the Episcopal Church. I loved the minister. I became confirmed. I became part of the church. I really loved going to church and receiving communion and all of that in church, as the Episcopals do. And then the minister died. And no longer, the church was never the same after that. And somehow he was a real ember. He must have been kept a lot of love there, I realize now, because when he was gone, the whole church changed. And so I left that. And also, they asked me to tithe. They say you have to give 10% of your weekly allowance to the church. This is like a church thing. And I looked and I said, well, I get 25 cents a week. I can't compute 2.5 cents. And I remember thinking, I'll give my life to the church. But not if you ask me. I'm not gonna have somebody extract that from me. I will willingly give my whole life to the church if I feel to do it. But I didn't like that extraction, that feeling demanding that money. So I left. Went on my merry way, started dancing and doing other things. So that was a taste I had of how things, sort of a divine little period in my life in the church. And that was about it. Otherwise, family, fun, all these things, and good health and all that. I was crazy. So then I went to college. I went to Berkeley, and I was majoring in nursing, and I ended up switching over to dance, which was great. And in the meantime, I met a young man that I fell madly in love with, my first boyfriend. I was head over heels in love with him. And we got married, and I knew the day I got married I'd made a mistake. Unfortunately, I wasn't quite strong enough to say, sorry, this is the wrong place. I'm in the wrong place at the wrong time. I just didn't have the strength to say that. Today I think I would. But so it was an unhappy marriage. And we went back to New York to live with First, I left my parents, I left my brothers and sisters, I left dancing, I left California, everything that was familiar, everything that I loved. And we went back to live in New York, where I'd hardly ever been, with his mother, who was an alcoholic, and his father, who was never there, and a Jamaican servant, who was darling. But he left in the day. He would take the train into town, train to be a stockbroker, go to the athletic club, come back at 10:30 at night. I'm alone in the house all day long. Clearly, I've made a bad decision. This person is not caring for me. He doesn't really care what I'm doing. He doesn't ask how my day is. And I'm stranded. I'm alone with the alcoholic mother in the house, who I love. But she was different. It was hard. So after about 2 months or so, I hit rock bottom. And I'm alone. And I'm desperate. And I'm going, this is a sad situation for poor me. I'm usually a happy person. I'm not happy right now. And I called out one night. I remember lying in bed like this. And I call out to, I don't know who, I don't know where. I just said, love, I know you exist, but where are you? I know you can feel it from whatever my life was in training. It's like that surety that love was there, but it wasn't happening for me. And boom, some light goes through. A little bit of light comes into the room. Not a strange thing, not an eerie, weird thing. Just a little gentle light comes into the room, and all of a sudden, I feel my back and my heart warm up, and I can see God's arm stretching down from the heavens, touched me on the back, and in a moment, I knew I'd been welded to God. And I hear the words, I am the source of love. I am the source of everything. And the love you're looking for, you won't find in the world. And what more could a person want? You know, all of a sudden, I felt like from that point on, I had everything I ever needed. And I didn't need to worry about this bad situation I was in and all these things. And then I heard the words, don't worry. And then this peace, this Buddhistic peace, just took me over. I was just all of a sudden gone. All that feeling was gone, and I was in bliss. I was just in bliss. And I just said to myself, I have, as I said, everything I need. And in retrospect, that little arm reaching down, not large arm, reaching down from heaven, had a pink coat when I think back. You know, just in my mind's eye, okay, the pink coat was there. I didn't recognize it at the time. So then 4 years later, we separated, and I went to a summer school of dance in Long Beach. And there was this marvelous group of people at the summer school of dance. I mean, we're saying Merce Cunningham was there, and all these high-powered dancers that were there and things. But there was this wonderful little crowd of people that just sort of liked to hang out together, and I liked them. I was drawn to them, and it happened to be Mitchell, Sarah Pearson, Jerry was there. Well, I'm bottle lovers, you know, but I didn't have any clue. I didn't have a clue what this was, but I was very drawn to this crowd of people. And I'd even seen a piece that Mitch had done, outdoor breakout piece. And I remember looking at that work, and I said, there's heart quality in that dance that I've never seen before in dance. I would love to perform with him. I didn't know anything. So at lunch one day, I'm sitting, and Sarah Pearson is sitting, and she's recently come from India, right? She'd recently been to India, I think not long. And she's sitting at a chair, and she's speaking very, very delicately, like an Indian woman, you know? And I'm entranced by this delightfulness. I didn't know what it was, and I went over, and I hear her say, Meher Baba was a holy man from India. And that's all I hear her say in the beginning, and I go, holy man. And that has a strong appeal to me. Coming out of this bad situation and all like this, and the notion of holiness was like, wow. Then I heard her say, Margaret Krauss teaches ballet in New York City, and she's been with him for 40 years. So the mind goes, how can he be holy if he's with this woman? Okay. So, natural, understandable response. But nevertheless, I was still attracted to these people and all, and so I'd heard Baba's name, so the seed was planted. Go back to Berkeley, have a whole year of performing there, and then I go back to live in New York and find out that Mitchell's back there and his lead dancer has just broken her ankle. Uh-huh. And I thought, isn't that nice? My dream come true, because I really, really, really wanted to perform. I felt sorry for her, but I was really happy for me, because I thought, this is a great experience. This is going to be a wonderful opportunity to perform and to work with, because I loved his work. And so we did. We danced together for a couple of years. Mitch, of course, he'd say, Here's the beloved Baba's book. Don't you want to look at that? And I'd be much, I'd Mitch, I like you, I like dance, I don't want to have anything to do with Baba. I have everything I need inside from that experience. I don't need anything outside of myself. I'm fine. Don't try and tell me, because I was so holding fast to this experience that I had that I needed, and it was supporting me, and it was like, it was sustained. It sustained me through a lot of unhappiness, and I was happy with my life, and I was dancing, and I was doing well. Okay. So he kept mentioning Baba here and there, and I'd hear him say, Jay Baba is somebody, and I'm going, sorry. And I remember we took a drive once, and he kept trying to mention Baba, and my stomach would get knots even thinking about Baba, right? I mean, I remember one time in particular. Until one day, I don't know, it'd been a couple of years, and I woke up in the morning, and I didn't know what it was. I said, it's my day today. That's all I knew. It was my day. And I mentioned to Mitch, because we had this wonderful dancing loft in the city, and I mentioned something to him. I don't know what we planned to do for the day. We were going to go to some spiritual speaker, Brother Free John, and I had all these ideas to do. I didn't know, you know, but I knew I had to do something special. So at the end of the day, Mitch suggested, or I suggested, I never really know, but I ended up saying, yes, let's go to Baba House. Let's go to Baba House today. I somehow knew. And we walked this wonderful walk over to Baba House. And I walked into the Baba House, which is a small, very small room, much smaller than this room, half the size. And the Don't Worry, Be Happy picture of Baba was a big one of these wonderful big, like about that size, was in front of me. And I walk in. And as I walk in, I'm flooded with love from this picture of Baba. Flooded. Love pouring out of his eyes. I'm just totally flooded with love. And I just remember saying, man, if this happens to me every time I walk in this room, I'm coming back here often. And I was swept away by these waves of glitter. Just beautiful love. And I felt like a bird at a fountain, you know? And just like refreshed, so refreshed. And all of a sudden I went, yeah. What I received 4 years ago from God, this matches it. Finally, I found something outside that matches that inner experience. And suddenly, there was this wonderful balance. And I went, yes, this is my life. I just knew it. This is my life now. This is what's happening for me now. And my immediate feeling was to wear a sandwich board that New York City needed Mayor Baba. And I thought, I'll wear a sandwich board with Baba's picture and walk around New York City because New York City needs Mayor Baba, and I'll just advertise him. Immediately, that was my feeling. And it reduced down to taking his name inwardly and wearing a Baba button. But I was smitten, as anybody is when they first start touched by Baba. And I just feel like I started taking his name, and, you know, walking all over the city, I would just take his name. And at that point, I was convinced that I needed to dance for Baba, take his name and really dance for him, and that would be my life's work. I was quite convinced of that, that would be the way that he wanted me to share his love. Very convinced of that. But another thing was happening in my life, and that was that I wasn't living the life that Baba wanted me to live according to his discourses. I loved the discourses, but I wasn't living that life. And I was ashamed of myself. And at a certain point, I said to myself, well, I frankly woke up one day and cried all day long. I was so upset with myself that I was not pleasing Baba. And I remember at the end of this day of crying, I said, there's one thing left for me in the whole universe. And that one thing is I've got to learn to live a life that he would be happy with. I can't stand this tension anymore. I can't stand this struggle anymore. I can't not do that. I've got to learn how to do that. And within 2 months' time, I was performing in Iran, and I was on my way to India and met Maran Mani, and there I was, right with those people that were going to show me how to live that life. But what happened was, right around that time, Adi was in America, and he was in New York City, and I said to Adi, please come to our loft. Raphael Gray can play some piano. This crazy lady can read some of her novel. Govinda can read some of her novel that she's written. We have some poetry. We have that... Michael Thais, the other one. The carpet, the guy, real handsome actor type, he was writing that, he would sing those funny songs. What was his name? Don't Stop, Rada. He sang that funny jazz song, Don't Stop, Rada. Anyhow, all these people, all the local wacky artists that I knew, I was going to have them come over. We were going to perform for Adi, and then Adi was going to give a talk about Baba. Well, on that very day that Adi was coming to the loft, I get a phone call from a lady, and she says, I understand you're a nice dancer and you can improvise, which I attribute to Mitch. He helped me learn how to improvise on the spot, dancing on the spot. I hear you can improvise well. I'm taking some dancers to Iran, 4 dancers, and I would like you to come along. I hear you're a good dancer. Can I come and see what you do? So at that point, I had a couple of pieces of Raphael's that I had choreographed to, and I said, I'm ready. Come over. The loft is clean. I'm warmed up. And so I'm saying Adia was due to come in about 4 hours. And she comes over, Marilyn Wood, her name was, and I did a couple of pieces, and she said, I like what you do. Please come with us to Iran. And I thought, holy cow. She's like, wait a minute. All of a sudden I can feel that is pulled to the east. And I'm going, something's shifting here. Something's changing. I don't want to leave New York. I don't want to leave dancing. I like where I am. I like what I'm doing right now. But something's changing. So Adia came that night, and I go, Adia, you'll never guess what happened today. I was invited to perform in Iran. And I said, well, I'm scared. I don't have a passport. I've never traveled. I know it's going to be good money. I'll probably go on to India after that. I've wanted to go to India, take Baba's darshan. And he looks at me and says, you go. If you miss the bus, you'll miss the golden tea. I don't know what he's talking about. I had no idea, but I'm on my way. I can tell I'm on my way. So we rehearsed for 2 months. We went to Tehran. We performed at the museum there and the Iran American Society. And then, boom, my friends went back to the States, and I was on my way to India. And that was a tough landing in India because Farhad thought he was giving me phone numbers of people to contact, and he'd given me their zip codes instead. So I had nothing to relate to. Except I did have an address of Nargisha's. So I went to Nargish and I got there. Thank God I got there. And slept for 24 hours. Then I went on to Nagar, and it took about, I went to Vilus, I went to Baba's tomb. I was on my way to Marizad, and I'm thinking, you know, I've taken my darshan, I'll meet the Mandali, I don't want to get out of shape, I want to get back to India, New York as fast as possible. I don't want to get out of shape, every dancer knows that. And I got to Marizad, and I remember sitting there and distinctly feeling, one thing. One thing funny about dance in me was that when I would dance, I felt so close to Baba. It's like, you know, anybody who's lost in an art form or whatever you're lost in, it's like, it's just you and me, Baba. This is all that's happening, and you're supporting me, and I'm dancing for you, and you're helping me, and I love you, and that whole thing, that's going on the whole time. And when I would not be dancing, I would miss dance, but I didn't really realize it was that communion with Baba that I was missing. But I would just sort of say, it would take me a half an hour, I'd go to a customer's friends and hymns, and it would take me a half an hour afterwards to come to grips with these deep feelings of longing. And I don't know what this is. You can't miss dancing like this. I've got to eat, I've got to shower, I have to wash my clothes. I can't dance 24 hours a day, but I'm missing these feelings, whatever this is. And so I got to Mara's hut, and I went to Mara's porch, and I met Mara. And suddenly I thought, the experience of Baba's love is so constant here. And there was a phase when I would put on my leotards and tights and perspire and feel close to Baba. I don't have to do that anymore. This is happening all the time here. This is like that bit of communion that I had with him there. This is a 24-hour experience here. And I love this. And I can't miss this now. I can't leave this now because I've been being prepared for this and I didn't even know it. So Baba just now, live for me, I'll just dance for me. And Mara made it real easy. Because there was the answer to my prayer. Here was the person who had helped me live a life that he would be happy with. And I adored her. I just, couldn't be away from her. I'll tell you, to be very honest, for 15 years I drove a scooter to Mara's home. And by Baba's grace, I didn't have accidents. Mara would always tell me, the minute you feel unsteady on the road, a car is coming, go off on the soft shoulder. Just go off on the soft shoulder. I spent half my life on the soft shoulder. And she saved my life, I'm sure, because, there were some bad things that can happen on that road. She was so concerned about that, wear your helmet and all these things. Half the days I left Marisol, I was in tears. I was always thought of myself as a relatively strong person, but I couldn't leave Marathon without falling. And there were two times I had to get off my scooter. I was crying so hard. And that's not normal. That's not normal. That's not, I'd say, Casey, this is not adult behavior. There's something really wrong here. But I would miss her so terribly the minute I would leave. And she would know that. She would sometimes even walk out to me when I would get on my scooter. She even put my little helmet on one time just to make me feel close, you know, I'll go with you, I'll go home with you. And then she let me do things, marvelous things, like she would have me, she taught me how to make curls in Baba's hair. It was a wonderful experience because you got the flavor of when they used to make, you know, they used to make for Baba, for not for Baba, but with Baba's hair and with his nails. They would sit in the East Room in the early days and they would, I'm sure you'd have one. They would make brooches. They would make in the shape of a bunny, a piece of cardboard, and then they would cover it with white wool. And then they would take Baba's hair and dampen it and train it to go around the outside of the bunny for hours. You know, and we were saying this sort of divine, quiet time that they would have Mara, Mani, Naja, all of them, worship Baba's nails. They would soak his nails and then run a needle through the nail and then be able to sew it onto something. Mani made this beautiful B-A-B-A necklace. With pearls and then Baba's nails on it, and then his hair all around a necklace for Mara that she would wear, and little bunny brooches and brooches for the hair, and all kinds of lovely things like that. And when Mara then was showing me what it was like to just simply make a curl out of Baba's hair so she could give it to somebody, because she didn't have time to do this anymore, it was like, you know, you just, God, that whole experience of what it was like for them in those days, that quiet, beautiful, divine energy going around, you know, just working with his things. To give to Adele and Phyllis and on and Virginia to send these people to the people in the West, especially. Or to pass back and forth with one another. But so, you know, she would share, you know, you just, you were in the atmosphere and she would, I was very lucky. I was very, very lucky. She would share these, the atmosphere and what that was like for them. And she would even trust me to the point where I would say, she'd say, now I need 15 pearls soon. So at one point I said, you know, Mara, I might be able to get some done if I take it home with me. And she trusted me to do that on the scooter, you know, and I was in my backpack. She, you know, I was here in my backpack, drive carefully like that and take it home and work on it and, you know, clean the table, put out a white paw, no wind or anything, and just get lost working on those things. That was really wonderful. What was it?
How many years you lived by Baba? How many years you stayed there?
Well, I for 15 years I took a scooter day in and day, every day I went there and left for 15 years. Those 10 years with Mara, doing a lot of work for her and then working with Mani, and then finally they built that new staff. They knew I was serious after 15 years. They knew I liked being there. They built the staff quarters and then they said Devon and I would be living there, which was great. That was great. I felt, and Mani was so cute, she said, you've done your time. She said, you've done your time. You can come here now. So like, you paid your debts or whatever they want. That was great. But one thing about Baba's curls, anyhow. Yeah. But she would also, then she was cute. When I would work on the curls and then I'd bring them back the next morning to Marathon. You know, it's not like, it's like this is her life. It's not, I'm just like ecstatic over one or two curls of Baba's hair. She's been doing this her whole life long. It's like her life. It's natural for her to do these things. So she, I'd give them to her and she'd go, yes, these will come useful. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I love the way she phrased it. These will come useful.
Did you first went there, or did you go as a guest when you go to Marathon every day, or were you going as a resident worker?
First one, this first 4 months. Oh, I was going to stay 10 days, and I stayed for 4 months that first time. I was a pilgrim that first, those first 4 months, I was definitely a pilgrim. They had to peel me off the wall of Monthly Hall on the 15th of March. I was really sick. I didn't want to go. But then I went straight away and got my entry visa and came back. And then at that point, I was a resident, and you're a resident real fast, and you are now, as they say, part of furniture, and that's it. You know, and there's preferential treatment. No. If you're there, if you're present, if you're serving, they interact with you, that's why you're there. And the more you can serve and the more opportunity you have to be with them, that's great. You're working for them, but that's why you're there. They're not going to say, come on over and be with us. If you're there and it happens, that's great. You know, but right away, there's a wonderful thing that Baba said to Mara that Mara would always tell us that when she first went to live in Maribod with Baba, and Baba said this to her when she first went there. It's a little phrase that Indian children learn when they're going to a new school or something like that. And he said, yeah, he said, it's the same thing. He says, you go to a new school, you come to live in the ashram, go to a new school, first 4 or 5 days, very nice. Everything is new, you're getting to know everybody, you're settling in. Fifth or sixth day, teacher tweaks you by the ear. By the 9th or 10th day, they're peeling your skin off. And I'll tell you, she, you know, when I said to myself, my gosh, Baba said that to her. Imagine, you know, I mean, I'm not joking. Yeah.
Casey, did Ben have more than one sister? She had
Franny.
And does Mehru speak very much about Franny? Did Mehru speak very much about Franny?
She would refer to her most of all in terms of the fact that it was her wedding that brought Baba to Mehru. She talked about her life in the early days in the ashram and the dances and the performances they would give. And let me go back a little. She would talk quite a bit about their early life because their father was that forest officer and he was this wonderful,
he was so
magnificent man. Even, you know, Baba's father was one of the pallbearers at her father's funeral. And he commented to Mani and the family what a magnificent stature that he had. An Indian man, beautiful shoulders, strong. And Mara said he loved, he would pick them both up like that and play with them. And she said he was so loving and wanted for them. He was a forest officer, which meant they had to travel all over India, you know, and set up camp. But these wonderful tents, he would have these marvelous tents, and they would even have a gramophone and he would play the records. And, you know, she told these wonderful stories of what it was like. It was an elegant life though they were out in the forest, you know, and he gave them every advantage. And he's the one who took her to, both she and Franny, their father took them to, I think it's called Hazrat Bal, a mosque in Sakhar, where she saw Muhammad's hair, you know about that? And how in the very beginning, when she was 4 years old, her father took Mara and her sister to a mosque that was well known for having one strand of Muhammad's hair. One strand. And she said, we walked, and now she's 4, and she's impressed by this beautiful mosque. And she walks in and they're waving peacock feathers and there's incense going and they very respectfully bring out this large box and then they open the box and there's another box inside that and there's another box inside that and it goes on box within a box within a box within a box down where there's this tiny little piece of hair and it's Muhammad's hair and all she remembered the reverence, you know, and then the peacock feathers would stop because they didn't want any wind and then open and there was one strand of his hair. So from a very early age, she got that sense of the specialness of the hair of the Prophet or Muhammad or God or whatever like that. So as soon as she was given the job of combing Baba's hair, I mean, there was never any question. Never should one strand of that fall on the floor, you know. She would comb his hair. She'd take a piece of kerchief and attach it to his shoulders and then sort of pin it to herself. And so when she would comb his hair, she would collect all of it, every strand. So she knew from that. So her father... So anyhow, she and her sister, yes, they went to that, and they were much loved and all of that. And then, of course, when it was Franny's turn to get, when it's time for her sister to get married, and, you know, it was Mara, by that point, she knew she didn't want to get married. She just wanted to be with Baba. And it was, you know, that story about the wedding, when she didn't go to Franny's wedding because of her knee swelling up and all like that. But really, she didn't go. The great thing is she didn't go because there was somebody else that they were going to try and fix up with Mara. She's really glad. She said it's sort of embarrassing to hear that, but so she just bypassed all of that, you know, and just said, Baba, flat out. I mean, but Franny, because of Franny's wedding, Baba came to Maribod. He came to Maribod, so that was a great thing.
I was just saying, when you were making curls of Baba's hair, I'm just thinking of the hair that Mother gave me. It's probably about 15 strands wound around in a little thing like that, and I'm wondering if you made them into curls like that, but like in that framed picture, or if by curls you meant wrapping
around.
No,
what you do, you take some, distill some good water, distilled water or something like that, you take the hairs, and you'd hold on to one and dampen it a little bit, and then find the end of another and hold on that and dampen that. And so I'd get, for Mara, she only wanted 3 didn't want to give away too much, but enough to make a substantial curl and dampen it on the pad. And then I took, she would take a pencil, just a pencil, a clean pencil.
Mm-hmm.
And then you start, you know, in that damp, you get it nice and damp, so it gets nice and sort of as one.
Mm-hmm.
And you just roll it around the pencil like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would take these new, you know, little clippies that I had that were soft enough, and I would clip them and then let them dry before you put it in the plastic bag. So obviously you want to nice and dry. So all it was just going round and round and round.
A little round circle. All
round and circle, yeah.
You might even have done the ones that Mother gave me.
I don't know. But I mean, Katie used to do them. No, Katie, Mara did them. Katie, actually, Katie was doing them, and Katie was telling Mara she didn't have time to do them either. And I just, and Mara, I'll never forget, Mara looked at me, she said, how did this fall in your lap? She was watching it also. That's the thing. She knew Bob was guiding the show. She knew that. And she would let these things happen. And that's a cute thing, you know. She probably said, man, who are you to be doing this? You know, but you're really lucky to be doing this now. But so, see, that's the kind of thing that they let happen.
Yeah. Well, probably it wasn't you something, because
I'm sure it was
60s.
No, way back.
And I would not have married with them.
I was only doing this. Now I was doing this, you know, for I don't know how many years. And you know, lots of other people did it.
I think I remember reading that Mayra. May Ruth had said, how we should keep that. It might have been a little piece of plastic that it was given to Mom in, but it should be in the paper or something, should it?
Well, actually, you can get archival quality plastic.
Oh, were you wrong? I doubt that this is, because this is how
probably it was given to Mama. Yeah.
And this
but
is
what they would say would be that, to do the same sort of thing, get a little thin piece of white fabric, mm-hmm. lay it out on the table, make sure there's no grease in there. And you can, open, you know, you can carefully open it, so you can cut the bag and open it up and then let it come out. And even reshape it if you need to with the same method.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you want to just put it in plastic, it'll be all right if you put it in archival plastic. I think, you know, hermetically sealed is probably better.
Yeah.
Some sort of vacuum thing is probably better. All the archivists would know better than I, but at the time, you're still giving Bob Scrolls in that archival. We have little archival bags now.
Mm-hmm. I already opened it and gave them. I took out one strand and gave it to my son.
That's okay, as long as you know.
And I don't know if he'd like the strands over there, so I figured it would be important to him.
Well, also that Randall Williams does beautiful things with rings and things like that. I know.
Right, yeah.
You know, all kinds of things you can do with it. But it's good to find out and make sure that it's, you know, and Mara was, you know, she'd always say, this is really cute, just make sure you don't buy a draft, you know. Because she just didn't want to see anything untoward happening.
Yeah.
And everything.
It's hard not to turn you back on a picture of Barbara. I mean, I have.
Well, it depends. No, that's a different story. That's different. What she's saying is in your mind. In your mind, never turn away from him. That's what she's saying to me. You know, because what you're saying is really true. You know, you walk. But I think what she's saying is you just, you know,
literally aware.
Yeah, that's right. It was an awareness thing. You know, if you feel he's in the picture, you know, if. You're surrounded by pictures, but maybe someday one of them strikes you. You don't just walk away from it, do you? You're engaged with that picture for a while, you know, and that's what she's doing.
I know. I'm very conscious of the fact that I am nowhere near. I mean, I would just give Mara a heart attack if she saw the way I dust the pictures of Barbara and
she was very things. Particular.
Oh, I know she was, but I'd pick it up and just go like this and put it back on.
She would do that.
Oh, really?
On her shoulders, they've all been known to do that because her shoulder's a pretty clean thing, you know. But they would do that. Like, oftentimes, there would be a picture in her room that she wanted to show to somebody, and she didn't do the dusting that often in her room, and it wasn't that bad. But she would say, make sure it's dusted, you know, and I would see her do that. Make sure it's dusted before you show people.
Well, I know Lynn McGuire is very particular because she had a lot of training with Mary about not putting Barbara's picture on the floor.
Definitely not.
Well, I've got what used to be my daughter's bedroom is Barbara's office. And I have paperwork on desk, chairs, the other desk, the bed, and the floor. It's an obstacle course because I've got orders waiting to be packed to send out. And there are photos and papers with Barbara's picture on the floor. But then everything's there. But every now and then, something will say, I'm on the floor, pick me up.
Well,
and I will.
Yeah.
And I'll be walking past it, I go, oh, okay. Pick it up.
As long as you do that, that's great.
Oh, yeah, I would never ignore
it. In light of what you do, in light of what. That's right. That's right. See, that's exactly what she's saying. Don't turn your back on that.
Yeah.
He's speaking to you like that. Don't turn your back.
And he does. And I'd say, oh God, I left it on the floor. I'm sorry, but hey, this is business. It's got to be there.
It was hard for her. When people would come and sing, you know, they'd have, naturally, you've got all your songbooks and things like this, and it's all Bob's songs. Maybe there's a picture of Bob on the front of the songbook. And they would put their things on the ground to play.
Yeah.
And you'd see her just, you know. There were times when she would say something, but she didn't feel it was the right thing. It just, it really hurt.
And I remember she said, when it's on t-shirts, don't put your t-shirt on the floor. And sometimes I just take it off, put it on. Uh-oh, that's Bob's picture. Hang it over the chair.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah,
I remember in the house once, somebody was putting an electrical cord behind one of Bob's pictures and just sort of lightly hit the picture with the cord as they were draping because there was we needed an extension cord or something. And my spirit was set, you know, with the way it was handled. And also, whenever I would clean anything, the Blue Bus or Monday Hall or in the house, anytime we take the pictures down to dust the walls and things, Money was very particular, you know, stack them all so he's upright. Not sideways, not so they're all different, not upside down. Unless you have to stack them this way, that's okay. Right. But always sort of, it just keeps him there. You know, in that way, you're just going, yes. And you're regarding them all the same. I don't know, they're just these little tricks that they would do. And it just, you keep going, okay, I can do that. I want to do that. I want to, you know. What else? Little things. Oh, this is a tough one. She'd always say, Mara would always say, it's easier to do than to not do. And I look at life right now, and I look around at all these things that are happening, and I say, now that's discipline. That's the essence, to me, that's the essence of discipline. That, you know, it's just, we're so active, especially in the West, we're so active, and she'd always say, just, you know, even consider not doing. It's not that you're not going to do it, but I mean, the other side of all of this activity, what's that? Well, just stop it. Suffering from being with Bob. Yeah.
I was just putting things together, what you were saying about, you know, the Puna house and how I felt Mira's presence so strong that Mani had kept her there during vacation. I was thinking about how so special Bob's presence is in his bedroom. And the last time I was there, it crossed my mind that it wasn't just Bob's presence for all of us, but it was because of the love that Mara could have got for him. And I just wondered if you felt that.
Very much. Yeah. Because everybody takes special, you know, no matter what she said about Bob's room, you know, and all of her planning for the future and how it's going to go and things like that, the things that she said were really trying to hold on to all of those things. Because, for example, she'd say, there really shouldn't be more than enough 5 people in Bob's room at one time. Have you come here to see one another, or have you come here to see him? No. Because it's really true, there's a big crowd in there. And the Indians, they're wonderful. I mean, they love big crowds and things like this. We, even for them, we try and tell them, you know, because they can understand, they do crowds. But we understand, I want to tell them, you know, let's not make this into a bus station, you know, because they'll just crowd and take darshan and leave, and they will save. I mean, it's a real experience for them. But still, in honor of Mara, you know, we'll say, no, that's just a few of you at a time, or whatever, okay. But Mani said a cute thing. She said, Baba put more of his physical presence into those walls than anywhere, which is true. And Mara, she told a cute story once. She said, Baba had told her to read Stay with God. And so here she is sitting in Baba's room. Baba's resting there. She's sitting in Baba's room. She's reading Stay with God. And she said, just struck me all of a sudden.
And Casey, when they do the archives of Mara, will it have a great deal of history from her early letters to Bob, for example?
Will that be archived
just of Mara?
I really don't know what form it's going to take. They're in the preserving stage right now. They're in the stage of making sure that they're keeping enough of their personal effects there to.
Yeah, those personal things.
Now, even for example, in Mara's room, a lot of the covers that she used to use, we just keep on the bed and then cover it up. Because that's the way it was, and you don't want to empty out, you know, we're not going to display those things, but just to keep it.
She didn't keep it
saturated. Who, Mara?
Did what?
A journal?
Did she
keep She wrote lots of beautiful little things. Little love poems to Bob. I think Jane Brown put one to music. somebody else has put them. She just lovely things she read. I'll tell you, I'll never forget this. I was in the house, and she was in the little bathing, not bathing, the little hand washing place right by Baba's door. She didn't know anybody was around. And I, now mind you, please, I'm not going to try and, I'm not going to come anywhere near the way she said this, but it just struck me. She's on her own, she's in the house, she's washing her hands, and I just hear her say, Baba. That in the middle of that, you know, just was, how do you archive that? But she would just, you know, she was always, she was in her thoughts, she would have a lovely thought about him, you know, because she loved poetry and she'd be inspired by the songs and she would, you know, talk about the days when they'd be strolling together in the hills, looking, longing for those days and why have you turned your back? Those kinds of poignant things like that, you know.
But you, of course, get a feeling for that in the biography that...
Oh, it's beautiful.
Beautiful.
That's beautiful.
I just wondered how much more of that would be...
Oh, there's more.
...available.
There's more because a lot of little things, a lot of her little artifacts, a lot of her little belongings, Gohir has gone over and she's written... Gohir and Nehru have told beautifully everything that they know about Baba's room. I mean, that's where a lot of little stories... Gohir would sit in Baba's room, tell the stories... Nehru would tell the stories of what Mara, what her activities were in there.
Mm-hmm.
Also in Mary Money's room, you know, they have all the little things in the cupboards and things. They're trying to piece together all the stories of all of those things as best they can. You know, you just reminded me of a story how Mara would say that when she, you know, after she was 50 or 60 years old, how the women get those warm flashes, hot flashes in their later life. And Mara was no exception. She had a pretty bad time with that, and she would get... quite warm. She was warm anyhow, warm-hearted, you know, and so it would intensify. And she said that the only time she ever had to leave Baba's room when he was present was when she would become so uncomfortable from one of these hot flashes, and she would have to leave the room. And she said, and when I left the room, it felt like an eternity until I could get back.
Yeah, I just had the question, and in my recent trip to India, I just remember this one incident of being in one of the mandalas, and it just so, of course, they're her pure soul, and it just the way he was looking at me, I kind of felt like he was seeing some of the impurities and, you know, in me, and so it was just so clear. And I wanted to ask this about Mihira, because since Baba said she is the purest soul in the universe, did you have any experience with her as far as, you know, like, I myself, like, a little bit, like, intimidated by that,
Sure.
I was speechless, sure. Didn't know how to, pass that moment. So, I was wondering if you had any experience like that with Mihira.
Oh, sure. She would pick up on all that kind of stuff. Because I remember saying, I want to live my life in such a way that I would be able to tell her everything that I do. That's how nuts I was at that. And then when something would happen that I would be ashamed of or whatever, feelings or thoughts or something like that, she would pick up on it. She, and at times she would, actually the cute thing that she would do is she would give me something. She would give me something and say, I know you're having a tough time or something like that. And that's about it. But that's the way she did it. And that's all you needed. She was in that compassion. She didn't want to delve into it. You know, she didn't think you needed to talk to anybody about anything. You take it all straight to Baba.
Mm-hmm.
She really was very firm about that. She didn't understand why other people needed to talk on discussions with the other Mandali about this or that. You know, but as far as she was concerned, you straight it out with Baba, you take it up with him, you know. So basically what she was saying was, yes, I feel for you because you're having a hard time. That in itself was lovely. That she would even feel that. She no blame, no guilt, no anything. Take it up to Baba. But you know, Erich said an interesting thing. He said, a perfect master puts a mirror in front of you. Now, really speaking, all that's doing is showing you, giving you a little dose of yourself. You go, yuck. But, yeah. But the avatar just gives love. So you have that double thing. Because he's the avatar, also had the function as a perfect master, he can do both. He can show you yourself in those awful moments. He's also then all love. But this is an interesting story that I was working, we're all working on things. This is something that I really felt was finally working out of my system. I was thinking, yeah, I think I've worked on that about long enough. I'm really tired of it, and I think we're all sick of this. And I walked into Baba's room for the prayers one morning. And as I'm walking into Baba's room, it somehow happened that every single person outside the room said something that heightened this thing in my mind of what I was trying to get rid of, you know, and I'm like, bam, bam, getting hit from all sides, like it's coming at me like this. And I'm like, how do all these people know what's going on inside? You know, I'm sort of staggering into Baba's room, and by the time I got in there, I was so sick. I mean, I'm saying sick of this thing. And I just threw it on the Baba's bed. Oh. I go, here, like that. And I look over Baba's picture, and he's brilliant. Beaming, so beautiful. And I've just thrown a handful of garbage. You'd never want to throw that at anybody. I've just thrown a substantial handful of garbage at him, and he's ecstatic, and he's happy. And I say, a great artist, you know, takes the palette, looks for the colors, look for the bright color, makes a beautiful canvas, creates a beautiful offering for God. But what makes him happiest is we throw the junk. And it was very startling when I saw that. I just saw him as that. Never seen what looks so beautiful. And that's what Erich says about he wants our imperfections. And it's hard to get rid of them. You know, you do have to get to the end of the rope. And a little thing that Erich used to say about that I was telling Karina was that Erich was sitting on the floor of Bombay Hall once, and I think maybe we were alone, actually. And he was talking about the process of evolution and reincarnation and involution and all that, and he had his hands on the floor of the hall. And he started, the wall was about here, and his hands are sort of creeping towards the wall, and he says, we gather experience, we gain through our lifetimes, we gain experiences. And then his little fingers touch the wall, and then he said, and then you arrive, and your deck is complete. You've got your 52 cards. This is what you're going to be playing with now. This is what you're playing with. And he said, and then you... It was as if his hands were full of ink spots, all of these 52 cards, you know. And then he goes like this. And then they're thrown up in front of you. You can see them. And suddenly then I saw like all these ink spots just scatter all over the wall. Then he took his fingers, and he just put his fingers on the wall, and then he just goes... And they're in front of you, he said, but then they just keep getting lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter.
Yeah. Speaking of Baba's room, I just recently read that the room upstairs used to be his bedroom. And I hadn't known that. I wondered what it is now. And
well, see, when they first built, because Mara designed the house. When they were first there was a small little building, and they liked the floor plan, sort of, but then she and Mary designed the house, but it was Mara's design. And they had it built, and originally Mara felt that Baba should live upstairs. There are two big rooms upstairs. The one on the west side was his room, the second room. And the biggest reason was that he had to have a man with him in the night, and the women were living down there, and the women were living right there. The women were living in Baba's room. Meru, Naja, and Gohair were living in Baba's room. What is now Baba's room? And so when they designed it, Baba was to live upstairs. And of course, from the 40s, when he went to live there, he could run up those stairs. But then after the second accident, he himself said, I don't want to come live downstairs because I have to have a man in the room in the night, and Mara's room is here, and how can I do this? You know, I want to give the women all separate. So for a year, he negotiated those stairs for that broken room. And they said he even went so far as to, he would tie a pillow to his bottom and scoop down the stairs. And I think something happened once, he tripped once, and it just was so excruciating. And since the accident, they were saying, please come live on the ground floor and make a space for you in it. Because previously he had lived in that room. They had vacated that room for a short while in 57 for some reason. he was sick and he couldn't go. Something. So they, there was already a hint that he lived in that room. So finally, he said, okay. Okay, I'll do that. So one morning, he came down the stairs. Mara and Gohir would go up the stairs and greet him. When the watchman would leave, then Mara and Gohir would go up and greet him and help him down the stairs. But then he said, okay. So he went to Monday Hall in his lift chair, and they raced, emptied. Meru went to where her room is, Naja went to the other room, Gohir went and put her bed outside Baba's room, and left a lot of the things in the room that were there. So the calendar, some of the things, the calendar of Jesus and Peter, that was a calendar, and that was Gohir's, and that was in there in their time, and that's still there. There's a picture of some flower pictures, those were left in there. And Baba went to the hall and came back with him, and they just took their things out, brought his stuff down, and then he said, okay.
And so that's upstairs.
His bed from Guru Prasad is in there, and a lot of treasures, and not necessarily archival things, but very precious things from Mara's time, or pictures of Baba that people have painted. That they, you know, they alternate the pictures in the house and stuff like that. So those are Mara takes care. She takes beautiful care of that. She stores everything really well, and curtains for the house, extra curtains, extra carpets for Baba's room. You know, stuff like that, too. But it's all for the house. It's all for Baba. It's also, now that is more storage for the women themselves. Their trunks and things. Some of Baba's things, now most of Baba's things have been taken to the archive places. They're keeping some of Baba's things there just to keep in the house, to have things there. But a lot of their personal things are there now. And it gets quite warm. I have to say, it gets quite warm. Very warm. Money tells the story once. I hear about that Phyllis sent Money a package of wildflower seeds. And Mary did all the garden, you know. But Money thought, I'll just plant these seeds. So she planted in the planter box outside the drawing room. There's a planter box there. She planted some seeds, and one started to grow up. It was a sunflower. And it started to grow, and it started to grow, and it grew all the way up to Baba's room. And the cute thing is that this flower, a sunflower, always faces the sun. And that was the west. And you would think that sunflower would have turned and faced that afternoon western sun, but no. That sunflower went up to Baba's room, and he was living there. And it faced right into Baba's room. Never faced anything.
Facing the sun.
Okay, then. Go ahead. Hang on one second. There's one thing.
Well, I've got a question I've been wanting to ask for years, and I keep forgetting, and you're the perfect person to answer it. It's very simple. How did Mara pronounce her name? So many people say Mahara, and others say Mara. How did she pronounce it?
Mara. But the R was like that sort of
Mara. Was the H was there?
Not Mara.
No.
You said the first
one, Mara? But not with an R. She'd sort of say Mara.
I remember reading in the Australian Baba magazine, one of the mayors in Australia wrote a little thing about that, and of course the Australians always have very weird pronunciation anyway, but she was saying some of them pronounce it Mehera, and some of them Mehra, and some of them Mehra.
Well, you know, they may want to use Mehera also. Mehra. You know, they may want to think about Baba at the same time. Mehra, when she was young, she didn't like her name. Mm. She wanted to change her name. She thought it was a very plain name. Of course, later on, she was quite happy.
So anyway, her pronunciation was Mehra.
And they'd say, go here, they say Gavir.
Gavir. Right, Australians always say Gavir.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She'd say Mehra.
Mm-hmm. You say go, honey.
Go,
honey.
Yeah.
I think it's just go, honey.
It's Gavir. Gavir.
Gavir.
One of the Spanish, and B's and B's and was there all.
One more thing. Mervan is Baba's name, it's not Mervan. It's Mehraban.
Mehraban.
But you all of you were said different, wrong.
No, in India they say Mervan.
Mervan is the
Actually, yeah, probably in the Parsi community, amongst the Parsi it's in, because I know like Mervan Jesawala, Erich's brother, Mehrwan, Mehrwan. So that's they've changed it. Right. They changed it. The marijuana, that's how they spell it.
Mehraban has not a meaning. I can't watch it father like that.
Yeah. And also I heard in Persian that marijuana There's also another translation that means the light just before dawn. The light that comes in the sky just
right,
before dawn.
Right.
That's also another translation.
When we were young child, we used to call God. We call Allah. We always were called Mehraban, Allah. Mehraban, Mehraban.
Light.
From beginning we were born, you know,
yeah.
Our
yeah.
Mind was that. But yes. It's Mehraban.
Are there any unknown videos available?
Actually, I took some. I took some little Super 8 videos that we hopefully
can see someday.
I hope so. There's some real charming ones.
Oh.
There's this really, I'll tell you, this cute thing happened. Somebody, David Fenster, handed me a Super 8 camera with sound film that he didn't want to use anymore when I was first there. And I go, man, I'm right here in the Garden of Mara. I'm going to take as much as I can of her. So I did. And there's this one picture, one movie. She's sitting on the porch, facing the Mumbai Hall, sitting on those little, you know, way at the edge of the porch. And I'm down on the ground filming her, and she's got the microphone in her hand. She's holding the microphone like this. And she's totally new at this, you know, holding the mic and being filmed. She can't quite figure, is there sound? Is there visual? You know, she doesn't really know what's going on. She was telling stories about Baba when he used to cheat at sports. She's being very funny, you know, clever guy.
What year was it?
78, 79, 80, early on. And so, and there was nobody there, and she was just sitting telling these cute stories. And she'd be telling a story, and then she'd sort of come to the end of the story. And now, mind you, I wasn't going to turn the camera off for anything.
Mm-hmm.
I just, this is on rolling. So, but she, it was fine with her. So she'd be talking like this, and then she'd come to the end of a little story, and she'd go, what shall I see next? So we have a little video. Yeah, we have a little.
Have you given those to Steve Edelman, or does he know about them?
They're being stored. She listened since 89. Now, I didn't even know if she was passed. It was time for her to pass away. But in about 89, he said all these things need to go in a cooler,
right.
Time. So I gave them to Sheila to store, so she has them.
Ah, well, hopefully Sharia will come out with them shortly.
Well, I hope so. They used a little of the footage in Mara's movie that Nehru made. Mara and Mara's beloved. A little of that footage is in there.
They have arranged for each other. In the past, I think.
Yeah, sure.
I think you've done some wonderful work, Casey and Dana, all these people around.
Well, everybody's.
The people around the church. I've seen some of their work. Mm-hmm. Do you suppose we're going to see what you just
said? Well, we'll see. I mean, it'd be nice to have them. Sure. Sure, be nice. I mean, they're rough. Home, we're saying home movies. Actually, there will be a project. There is a project in the works to try and get the color up a little bit better, and they're going to start. They're actually going to try and start to do that. They are. It's probably in this year we'll start to work on it. Because there's some stuff that doesn't need to, you know, I'm shooting into the sun, and nobody needs to see that. The camera's off. That kind of stuff. She actually, in Baba's room, this is really quite funny. I said, let's take. Or she said, one of us said, let's do a little talking history of Grand Baba's room with the camera and her on the microphone and things like that. So she said, so if you walk into Baba's room from the other door, there's a little pink bench as soon as you walk in. So she was sitting on the pink bench, and I had the camera, and I was going around the room, and she would talk about various things around the room. And it was really very sweet. I mean, not comprehensive or anything, but very touching. And then I came around at the end, and the camera came around, and I just hand a little bit on her, and she gave a little sweet little message about loving Baba, how he suffered, and all these things. So it was our turn to love him. That kind of thing. To love him. It was very touching. And so then afterwards, she looked at me. She said, I don't think there was enough light in there. I don't think it won't come out unless Baba wants it. No, it came out. So it was cute. She even said that she was willing to do it, but she's.
I feel whatever was done was meant to be done.
Well, you know, the good stuff and the bad stuff. I once said to her, I had made some stupid mistake, and I, you know, just feel terrible. And I looked at her and I said, you know, Mara, I said, I feel really bad. I said, this is your home, and we're here doing these things, and we're making mistakes, and you have to suffer because of our mistakes and all. And she looked, she said, it's not like that. And I thought, no. They must have goofed up in front of Mama, and they knew it was all for his sake. It's all for the learning. She knew. You know, she really had, she knew we were there. We were the people that Baba had brought. We were going to goof up. We were going to make mistakes. We were also going to learn in the process. We were going to get maybe to love Baba a little bit more at the end of the experience. She just knew, that's the point I was trying to make about when somebody else is offering. It may look junky, it may look wrong, it may look in the wrong place, it's the wrong item, it's the wrong offering, it's the wrong whatever. But the fact is you've come that far, and this is where you are in your month of Bhava. This is your offering. This is what you're doing right now. You're going to learn from it. He's either going to accept it hook, line, and sinker. He's not going to like it. You're going to learn from it. And we all, my feeling is, have to appreciate, and I have to learn this as much as anybody, have to appreciate what 100 offerings are and accept them where they are now. You know, I attend in India. I attend, and I'm looking around at these people who live there. I'm like, my God, you're a resident. You're doing this kind of behavior. You know, you're not affecting Bhava well and all this. I'm very guilty of doing that. And people, you know, and I have to say, hang on, you know. They are where they are. He's brought them here. Who knows who's going to be touched by what they're doing? Who knows? You know, and we can't tell what's ahead in the future and who's going to come and who needs what and all that kind of thing. So let it be.
That's a very good point in tolerance.
Everywhere. Mm. You say to yourself, Bhava's love is behind that. It's brought them that far, you know, and it's going to blossom. Oh, I could be more tolerant.
Oh, I've been trying tolerance in the duty for 10 years. It won't go away. Intolerance, I mean.
I was going to the duty one night, and Eric says, why are you going to the duty? And I go, Eric, I love to go to the duty. I love to throw things away. He says, you don't need to go to the duty. Just sit next to somebody who's smoking. Mind blowers. I mean, you go, wait a minute, where this is a terrible program, we're supposed to be doing this.
Can see. Yes. Yes. I found out the bed in Baba's room. His original bed that Baba really was sleeping.
Yes, yes.
And the mattress.
Oh, yes, all of it.
The mattress too.
We unfortunately had to reinforce the mattress a little because people pressed down on it too much. Uh-huh, and so
but
we had to.
Real mattress.
The bed that Baba was resting on when he dropped his body is in the blue bus.
I saw that, yes, yeah. Yes.
But that was only, he was only on that for about a week. Otherwise, that bed, yeah. That, and Mary wanted this bed to be brought back into the room. She said he was happy here. He wanted some money.
How about the pillow?
All of it. Pillows.
Baba is to be the same pillow.
Pillows.
Only pillow cases to be changed.
Pillow cases are changed. The bed covers are changed. But a lot of the things, a lot of his bed covers are underneath that. You know, there a lot of his things are there. And then they have to cover it with a big white sheet. And then they cover it with a decorative sheet. So they're protected. But lots of his
things. But original pillow ball.
All of that. And even the little carpet that's... You know,
original.
Okay. Not on the floor, but the carpet that, you know, on the bed itself.
Right.
Without the mattress, it's wooden.
Right.
You put a carpet down, then you put the.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yes. It's original.
So, Meru, once a year, she does a beautiful job airing that, you know, opening it all out, airing all of the
pieces
of cloth and things like that. She does a beautiful job.
Oh, okay. Thank you. And next time I'm going to eat that pillow.
You can see just what else you can eat.
You mean you're going back? He's like,
no.
There's something else for you to eat. In 1960, no. 1989, I wasn't with Mary when she went to Bhava, which was very hard for me. I'd gone to the States. My last time seeing her, I remember saying, Mary, I'm looking forward to seeing my family in America, but I know I miss you. And she looked up at me and she said, it was as if I'd said the right thing. She looked up and she said, it's all right. When you get there, you'll get into that atmosphere. It'll be fine, she says. You'll make the transition. You'll be there. She said, just bring Baba to you and love him. And that was really the last thing she said to me. And she handed me some sweets. You know, she'd always give you those little orange prasads yes. from Baba's home to your home. And she handed me some sweets then. And that was the last time I saw her, so I always kept those. So last year and also this year, I thought, Karina, if you'd help me, we'll bake a cake and melt some of the prasad
wow.
into the cake.
That's nice.
And so that's there for you. And also there's some roses that are all from Baba's bed box. You're free to take one.
Casey, did you try and come back to India once you heard that she was...
Oh, I came back immediately. I came back hearing she was not well.
Yeah, because Jane Brown took off, by the way.
Oh, immediately. As soon as, I mean, I had...
She missed her.
How's this for tough? I mean, I've been real close for like those 10 years. I get into the compound, and I didn't know how she was. And I get into the compound, and I look at Pat, and I say, how was she? And Pat said, we had her service 3 hours ago. Oh, no.
So, that took a while to still get some of that. Yeah, that was hard. But as somebody said, you know, she wanted you to remember her life of Berkeley.
Because I remember that time Jane left Myrtle Beach and got off stage with me, and I was writing a piece.
That's for right.
The liberation about her passing away.
Well, it was a very special time.
Yeah.
Very special time.
Bob was standing all out of my mom.
Oh.
It was interesting. I remember that.
Yeah.
So you did come back home, but
immediately. I remember our airplane got, there was a typhoon in Hong Kong, so we had to put down in Taiwan. I was like, you know, does anybody know what's happening in the universe right now? Mira is not well, and she may not be here any longer. I have to be shuttled with 350 other people into this big room in Taiwan and given old sandwiches. And I just can't quite believe this is all happening. It was really devastating. Really devastating.
That's hard.
But then I had it, then 9 months later, I'll have to tell you this because this is how Baba helps. 9 months later, after she'd gone, and I really, another bit of my non-adult behavior I'd lie on the bed and cry for long times, you know, and I just go, this is not healthy, this is not adult behavior, you know, I mean, whatever that connection was, you know, so, but after all this sadness and not even wanting, you know, thinking, she never loved me, she never knew me, I was never here, we never had fun, you know, that whole, all that denial, you just can't handle it all. And in February, February, just before Baba's birthday, I went to sleep and I dreamt of her. And I dreamt, what I dreamt was, I went into the house and I knew she was there, but I couldn't see her anywhere, I couldn't feel her there, everything was wrong. People were doing her, the wrong people were in her room, wrong people were doing her work. She wasn't there, everything was heavy, there was this very heavy feeling, and it was very depressing. I walked into the house and Mara's clearly not here, but I know she's here, that same feeling. And I walked in the dream, I walked over to the dressing room where when I would sew for her, she would come out of this little dressing room. And I walked over, and suddenly she's standing right next to me. She puts her arm around me like that, and she just pulls me a little closer to her like that, and we start to walk. Just gently start to walk together like that.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, I'm keeping you close to me. I'm keeping you very near. And that was great. That was great. I thought, no, she's back and she's here. I can reconnect with her again. The pain is very painful. Very painful. That was very hard. I truly, you know. Then that's why something like this today, you know, you want to remember Liz. Yeah, that was there. It did happen.
Anybody said it's the real Mr.
Both of them. I mean, now, you know, it's like, they were in class act. I mean, they were spiritually wise, intelligent, loving, nonstop service to Baba. All these things. I mean, they were not just unique. I mean, they were, look, he came down and he brought these two people. And he said, they're so special to him. How special they have to be. You can't even Mary made you feel whatever you were doing, you were loving God. Money made you feel whatever you were doing, you were serving him. But it wasn't me doing it. She was inspiring it. Mary was inspiring it. Money was inspiring it. So without him, it's like, man, I'm a desert over here. You know, there's not much happening. And then you have to start to get your own, build your own fires, get your own enthusiasm, and figure out what he really means and how am I going to do this and stuff. Because they would inspire you to do. Now, Mara, for example, went on routine. This is when she knew I could dance on those shoes. Went on Ramatithi. In the early days during Ramatithi, we used to, if you were a downhill volunteer, any of you that have been there, we used to throw mattresses for hours at a time. We would provide tents and mattresses for all of them. Mattresses. Everything was provided. And we're saying, dusty tent, 600 mattresses, four of us. Throwing mattresses like dealing cards, and you're tired, and your feet hurt, and you're dusty, and you know, and then you do tent duty after that, and you really don't go up the hill very much because your duty is down the hill, and it's
it was hard. And you wanted to be up the hill and join up there, but you're down. Okay. It's the 31st of January in the afternoon. I was exhausted. My feet were swollen. I could hardly walk. And the message comes down. Mara wants you to dance tonight. On those shoes. And my first thought is, these bad things, they'll never fit in the shoes. And I was like, it was terrible. I just thought, how could you do this? You know, I'm sorry with that. I have to do it. But I don't know how I'm going to do this. Got up there, had my costume. I don't know why I had my costume with me, or maybe it was in the costume in here. Put on my costume, nice, pretty pink costume I used for another dance. Put the shoes on. And I hadn't set a piece. I was using the Poffle Bell Cannon, which is a nice piece that I knew very well. But I'd only set about, I was working on this dance for something else, and I'd set about the first minute of it. It's a long piece, which means I was up there in front of 15,000 people, under lights, in this costume, jam my feet in these shoes, and I'm going to improvise in front of all these people all by myself. And Mara's right there in the audience. And so I got up there and I did it, and whatever I did, I did. And at the end of the dance, she looks at me and she says, I was nervous. And she looks at me and she says, "Oh, you were up on your toes quite a bit." And I felt like saying, jumping out of my skin, are you serious? So, but I was, and I, what can you do? I mean, I just thought, you know. But that was stretching it. I mean, I said, I'll never be able to do this. And it worked, and I did it, and she liked it.